Blackstone Audio presents The Burning Shore, How Hitler's U-Boats Brought World War II to America, by Ed Offley. This book is read by Robertson Dean. This book is dedicated to John Shearer Tuck, Staff Sergeant, USAAF, October 13, 1917 to November 14, 2012. A member of the greatest generation, a loving father, and a cherished friend. Introduction. The Battle Offshore. Viewed from the air, the North Carolina coast would not have resembled a major battlefield. Yet, as the sun climbed above the eastern horizon, bathing the pine scrub forests and inland waterways in a brilliant orange light, a brutal and desperate struggle was raging just offshore. On Tuesday, July 9, 1942, the area was a critical combat theater of World War II, as it had been for the past 6 months. A confluence of factors had made this intersection of land and ocean the fulcrum of the ongoing naval confrontation between Nazi Germany and the Western Allies, a vicious maritime clash now known as the Battle of the Atlantic. By July 1942, the combatants had expanded beyond the British Empire and Nazi Germany. America's entry into the war against Germany on December 11, 1941, had thrown the U.S. military into the fray. In turn, Hitler's U-Boot-Waffe, or U-Boat Force, initiated an all-out war against American merchant shipping. Vize-Admiral, Vice Admiral Karl Dönitz, Commander-in-Chief of the U-Boat Force, aimed to win a guerre de course against the Western Allies, sinking their merchant ships at a rate faster than new construction could replace them. Aware that American supplies were the lifeline keeping Britain in the war, his strategic imperative was to starve the import-dependent United Kingdom out of the fight, thereby depriving the Allies of a launching pad for an invasion of Nazi-occupied Europe. Beginning in early 1942, Germany's U-boat forces had shifted their operations from the mid-Atlantic to the American coastline, where Allied merchant vessels steamed as they took on supplies in East Coast ports or proceeded from the Caribbean with cargoes for England. Each day, scores of merchantmen traveled independently through those unprotected waters. Between the Newfoundland Grand Banks and the shallow waters off Florida, the richest hunting ground for the U-boats was the expanse of Atlantic Ocean off the North Carolina coast. In the waters off Cape Hatteras, climate, geography, and ocean currents combined to create a bottleneck through which merchant ships had to pass as they steamed along the coast. Several dozen miles out from the string of barrier islands known as the Outer Banks, the Gulf Stream constantly flows north from warmer latitudes. Driven by prevailing westerlies and fed by saltwater currents emerging from the Caribbean and West Indies, this river of warmer water, usually about 60 miles wide and 4,000 feet deep, powers along the eastern seaboard at an average speed of 5 nautical miles per hour. When it reaches Cape Hatteras, about halfway down the Outer Banks, the Gulf Stream collides with the colder waters of the southerly Labrador Current, producing fog, extreme waves, and frequent storms. To avoid these offshore hazards and the treacherous conditions closer inshore, merchant ships were forced to thread a 30 to 50 mile wide needle between the Outer Banks and the Gulf Stream. The German U-boat sailors stalking those cargo-laden targets favored this area as a lucrative target area. U-boat commanders loved Cape Hatteras for a second reason. The underwater topography along the North Carolina coast provided protection that greatly offset the World War II-era U-boat's one serious weakness. Powered by diesel engines on the surface and battery-driven electric motors while submerged, the U-boats in 1942 were extremely vulnerable to detection by aircraft and sonar-equipped warships when operating in shallow waters. While the continental shelf is over 100 miles wide off the mid-Atlantic states and Florida, making it difficult for U-boats to operate there with any degree of secrecy, off Cape Hatteras, the seabed quickly drops to several hundred feet in just a couple dozen miles to the east, creating a readily accessible hiding spot during the dangerous daylight hours. The deep water haven served the U-boats well. By July 7th, U-boats operating off the Outer Banks had sunk 45 merchant ships, totaling 262,137 gross registered tons. In the first half of 1942, the Allies had suffered a devastating and prolonged defeat in the Western Atlantic. Plagued by shortages of aircraft and warships and hobbled by poor training and inferior weaponry, the U.S. Navy and U.S. Army Air Forces, USAAF, achieved scant results in their effort to halt U-boat attacks on merchant ships. Thus far in the battle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.